into pieces.
For a brief moment in the late 90s and early 2000s, new metal ruled the airwaves, with releases such as KoRn's Follow the Leader, Limp Bizkit's Significant Other, and Linkin Park's Hybrid Theory. The genre had commercial clout, but critically fared less well. However, if you were a teenager at the time, nothing else felt like its white-knuckled, throat-shredding catharsis. Not only that, but the genre fused together many different sonic elements that previously seemed incompatible. But how did we get here? What were the vital steps along the way? And was it really all for the Nookie? This is how new metal became pop. As early as 1980, rock bands were experimenting with rapping in their songs. The Clash with the Magnificent Seven from Sandinista.
Luther King and the Hatman Gandhi went to the park to check on the game, but they was murdered by the other team.
While Blondie would top the Billboard chart with their attempt, Rapture.
Fat Five Freddy told me everybody slide, DJ spinning, I said my, Flash is fast.
But they gave off an air of novelty. The first true breakout moments were formed by Run DMC. The New York trio had first toyed with mixing their raps with squealing guitars on 1984's Rock Box. And 85's King of Rock.
Now we crash through walls, come through floors, bust through ceiling, knock down doors. And when we're on the tape.
But their cover of Aerosmith's Walk This Way from 1986 became the perfect crossover track. The original from 1975 had Steven Tyler's percussive, syllable-focused lyrics. And a drum intro that Run DMC had been looping and rapping over since they were in their teens. It was their producer and head of Def Jam Records, Rick Rubin, that had suggested and managed to recruit Tyler and guitarist Joe Perry for the collaboration. I was looking for a way to bridge that gap in the story of finding a piece of music that was familiar and already hip-hop friendly, so that on the hip-hop side it would make sense, and on the non-hip-hop side, you'd see it wasn't so far away.
She told me to walk this way, told you later.
At the time, rap music was rarely played on radio or MTV. Partly this was down to it still being perceived as new music, but mostly, racial bias was at play. In the 3 years since Michael Jackson fought his way onto MTV with Eddie Van Halen on Beat It, the channel was still not really playing black artists, unless they were conforming to white rock standards. Walk This Way was sonically familiar enough to contemporary hair metal to be played on rock radio and MTV, but also a revolutionary rap song. Its music video shows the previous divide. Run DMC in a tiny recording setup, Aerosmith in a massive club, before the wall between them gets broken down. Not only did the song literally break down the wall between rock and rap, but opened the mainstream to hip-hop. Walk This Way would hit the Billboard's top 5, and started a wave of interest that eventually led MTV to introduce Yo MTV Raps, 2 hours a week devoted to a genre they'd previously maligned. But Run DMC weren't the only rap artists on Def Jam using rock music to further their style. LL Cool J's Rock the Bells from 1985 used staccato guitar stabs. In a similar way to Jay-Z's 99 Problems, 2 decades later, also by Rick Rubin.
Hit me. 99 pounds, but a bitch ain't one.
While Beastie Boys' first single for Def Jam, Rock Hard from 1984, would sample AC/DC's Back in Black.
The finishing touch is the vocals that slam, the final blow in the bopping the jam.
They would continue the AC/DC plundering on 1986's No Sleep Till Brooklyn.
Aye.
an early melding point between rap and metal. Its title references Motorhead's live album, No Sleep Till Hammersmith, and they hired Slayer's Kerry King to perform a spoof metal solo. Its parent album, License to Ill, would continue sampling rock gods. And due to its hard partying music videos dominating MTV and appealing to suburban kids, it ended up being the first rap album to top the US Billboard chart. The Beastie Boys' License to Ill was when I realized, damn, I can rap now. So I started rapping right away. Before that, I'd go to the high school football games, and I used to rap in a big circle, and there would be beatboxes. But nobody would really take me seriously, because I wasn't black. At the same time in California, various bands were mashing up punk, funk, rap, and metal into a chaotic stew. All these bands would impact the new metal wave that would start playing the same clubs half a decade later, with Red Hot Chili Peppers' Anthony Kiedis in particular getting the rhythmic half-sung vocal style spot on. Faith No More also existed in this context, but were heavier and weirder, yet were the first to break into the mainstream, with its ka-chunking metallic bass and drum groove. And vocalist Chuck Mosley rapping an ironic screed against apathy. We 1987's We Care A Lot would be an early staple of MTV Alternative Showcase, 120 minutes. By 1990, they had replaced Mosley with the acrobatic vocals of teenage wunderkind Mike Patton. You will never understand it because it happens too fast, and it feels so good inside, walking the glass. And scored a top 10 Billboard hit with the grandiose rap metal of Epic. The song was not only a prototype for the anthemic pop metal of Linkin Park, but it also was one of the first signs that alternative music, previously underground music played solely on college radio, could in fact be potentially lucrative. Within 12 months of Epic's chart coup, Nirvana had forever shattered the line between alternative and pop music. Faith No More's follow-up, The Jagged Menstruating Heart of Angel Dust from 1992, would be an uncommercial flop. But influenced the more avant-garde new metal bands like Slipknot, Incubus, and System of a Down, as would Patton's other band, the clown metal lunacy of Mr. Bungle. But California wasn't the only place that was producing cutting-edge funk metal. New York's Living Colour were fusing Led Zeppelin, Bad Brains, and jazz. While Urban Dance Squad from the Netherlands mixed in samples and Chuck D urgency to their eclectic rap rock. Legend has it that Rage Against the Machine formed after having attended the Dutch Mob's first show in LA, but Tom Morello has since firmly debunked this. Thrash metal was also an influence on nu metal, at least the volume and heaviness. However, nu metal guitarists would mostly reject the precision riffing and speed showcased by 80s Metallica and Slayer. Another in the thrash big four that deserve a mention in the new metal conversation are Anthrax. Being from New York, they, but especially their guitarist Scott Ian, were absorbing the hip-hop boom happening around them. In 1987, they would even try their hand at their own metallic rap song on I'm the Man. No! Anthrax, and we take no shit, and we don't care for writing it. Ian in particular was a fan of Public Enemy, and would often be seen wearing their t-shirts live. Public Enemy's Chuck D spotted this, and gave Anthrax a name check on their 1988 track, Bring the Noise. To continue the cross-genre Mutual Respect Society, Anthrax produced a metal redo in 1991, and got Chuck D and Flavor Flav on board. With Ian himself rapping through the third verse. However, this wasn't the first time Public Enemy had rapped over thrash metal guitar, previously sampling Slayer's Angel of Death on She Watched Channel Zero.
Think I can handle, she goes channel to channel, cold looking for that hero. She watched Channel Zero.
The Anthrax Public Enemy collaboration would lead to a joint tour, closing each night together performing Bring the Noise. It proved that hip-hop and metal weren't too dissimilar. All attitude, volume, and f*** you energy. As we played that song, we'd see a sea of thousands of people, all understanding what they had just witnessed. In a sense, we taught people a lesson, every night. And it opened the door for the music that came in the 90s. Outside of awkwardly smashing rap and rock together, the ungodly, ugly crunch of new metal was pummeled into existence by New York's Helmet. Equally inspired by the groove of Gang of Four, the complex simplicity of AC/DC, and the sheer noise of Sonic Youth, their debut, 1990's Strap It On, had caught the attention of Interscope, with the band signed in the post-Nirvana Gold Rush. Riffologist Paige Hamilton studied jazz guitar, but upon realizing that ultimate bebop had already been achieved, he lent his awkward time signatures to the worlds of metal and hardcore. The band's first album on Interscope, 1992's Meantime, took the pneumatic riffing and buffed it to a mainstream sheen, with no compromise on heaviness. Pseudo-title track In the Meantime and single Unsung sledgehammer out an impressive drop D groove that future new metal bands would simplify for their own purposes. I listen to new metal and I see no musical soul whatsoever that resembles what Helmet is. Trent Reznor gave me a hard time once. He was like, "You need to fix this. You invented it." And I'm like, "I did not." They just figured out that it was easier to play in drop tuning, but still, none of them can play like us. Adding to their new metal parentage, Helmet were one of the first acts to sign on to the Judgment Night soundtrack, an album's worth of rock and rap acts collaborating, ranging from Slayer and Ice-T covering UK crust punks, The Exploited. To Faith No More joining forces with American Samoan rap squad, the Booyah Tribe. Just another victim, Helmet's track with House of Pain was less a collaboration and more two different versions of the same song bolted together.
You're just another victim, kid. You're just another victim. You're just another victim.
The film itself is mostly forgotten today, but its soundtrack reaching number 17 on the Billboard chart would set America up for what was to come. Another New York band that was putting out off-kilter alt-metal was Prong. From 1990's Beg to Differ onwards, frontman Tommy Victor was unleashing his signature palm-muted hulking staccato riffs. Only for them to be assimilated by KoRn and Limp Bizkit. In the aftermath of Walk This Way, hip-hop singles would start sneaking into the US Billboard Top 20 for the first time.
So be my queen if you know what I mean, and let's do the wild thing. says she wanna dance cause she likes the groove. So come on, fatso, and just bust the move.
But you say he's just a friend. But you say he's just a friend.
From London to the Bay, it's hammer, go hammer, empty hammer, yo hammer, and the rest can't go in play. Can't touch this.
Unfortunately, the first hip-hop song to hit the top spot was by Vanilla Ice.
If there was a problem, yo, I'll solve it. Check out the hook while my DJ revolves it.
Because of this mainstream infiltration, by the beginning of the 90s, listening to hip-hop had spread to the suburbs. In a similar way to how punk and metal had been the anti-authority music of their day, hip-hop shocked the mainstream, was misunderstood by white middle-class parents, but loved by their offspring. Pioneered by Schoolie D and Ice-T, but perfected by N.W.A.'s 1988 album Straight Outta Compton, gangster rap depicted black life in white America, detailing guns, drugs, and social oppression. And while the average suburban teen couldn't relate to the tales of street life, they latched upon the anger and spitting at authority on tracks like F*** the Police.
Yo, Dre, I got something to say.
Head and I enjoyed NWA when we first started, still do, and followed all the solo careers they embarked upon in the aftermath, like when Dr. Dre made The Chronic.
It's like this and like that and like this and it's like that and like this and like that and
He was using a lot of samples, and we were really trying to emulate that with our guitars. KoRn would even cover the 1992 track Wicked from NWA member Ice Cube.
Kick it, cause I get wicked.
With help from Deftones' Chino Moreno on Life is Peachy. Cube would return the favour by supplying some verses on the 1998 track Children of the KoRn. And joined the lineup for the same year's KoRn curated Family Values Tour. However, other non-NWA affiliated 90s hip hop artists also impacted the new metal crop. California's Cypress Hill would be an early crossover group, beloved by both hip hop and metalheads, united by the power of weed. 1991's How I Could Just Kill a Man matched a thumping, dirty hip hop beat. With Jimi Hendrix guitar squeals in the chorus. Not to mention its concluding, if you know, you know, reference to suicidal tendencies institutionalized.
All I wanted was a Pepsi, just one Pepsi, and she wouldn't give it to me, just a Pepsi.
All I wanted was a Pepsi.
The amorphous East Coast collective, Wu-Tang Clan, would pass their hip-hop through the filter of comic books and 70s kung fu cinema. Debut LP Enter the Wu-Tang, 36 Chambers, Ruckus, would lead to an ambitious but ultimately abandoned 1997 tour with Rage Against the Machine, as well as System of a Down covering one of its tracks with the RZA on the 2000 Loud Rocks compilation.
Like 20 white boys in the back of a pickup truck with hockey pucks and skateboards on the way to Woodstock. Leave home the Glock.
Another West Coast hip-hop artist that dove into the world of metal was Ice-T, who formed the fresh group Body Count in 1990.
Come on, body count's in the house, body count's in the house.
The white kids are very open for a black rock band, if it's done right. They just want to make sure you're not posing, you know? Where Slayer would deal with their satanic shit, I deal with my urban shit, bringing the Ice-T visions to the track. The most infamous song took the anti-police stance of F*** the Police to its logical endpoint. Banned in the aftermath of the LA riots, 1992's Cop Killer is still not available on streaming.
Cop Killer!
What do you want to be when you throw up?
Cop Killer!
Good choice.
Cop Killer!
Also from Los Angeles and politically minded in a way that few new metal bands would be, Rage Against the Machine's self-titled debut is packed with left-minded sloganeering, combating police brutality, government oppression, and capitalism. The band's signature song, Killing in the Name, combined the punk rock anger of the Sex Pistols and Public Enemy with militant funk metal, refined from Faith No More. A searing attack on the LAPD, contrary to popular belief, written before the Rodney King riots. The track encapsulates the message down to 5 lines, repeated as mantra.
Some of those that work forces are the same that burn crosses.
Until its final cathartic eruption. When it debuted at number 27 in the UK, a Radio 1 DJ would unknowingly play an uncensored version of the track on the chart rundown, provoking a deluge of angry phone calls. Though it had a specific target in mind, teenagers would claim its closing salvo as a catch-all catchphrase against authority, whether that was parents or teachers. And much to the band's disgust, new metal would also claim their metallic hip-hop sound for their own and downgrade their righteous fury to an adolescent tantrum. Years later, Rage bassist Tim Comerford said, "I do apologize for Limp Bizkit. I really do. I feel really bad that we inspired such bullshit." Meanwhile, interesting things were happening in metal. Texas's Pantera had left their glam metal past in the 80s and taken the heaviness of thrash and slowed it down to mid-tempo, as a result, making it all the more crushing. What became known as groove metal. Feeling that Metallica had abandoned their fresh roots with 1991's The Black Album, 92's Vulgar Display of Power was Pantera's attempt to take their place in the metal major league. With the album's 4 single, Walk, they more than made their case. It aggressively swaggers with Dimebag, then Diamond Darrell's lurching 12-8 riff, and his brother Vinnie Paul's shuffling beat, borrowed from ZZ Top. Frontman Phil Anselmo channels Black Flag's Henry Rollins as he strongly intones his words, telling his target quite insistently to get out of his face.
Be yourself, by yourself, stay away from me.
Vulgar Display of Power was the absolute stripping away of all the bullshit and letting everything come out emotionally, and going for the money riff right off the bat. It truly encapsulated the Pantera sound. KoRn and Slipknot would take the riffs, while Deftones would enlist their producer Terry Date for their first 4 albums, as well as their 2020 album, Ohms. But Pantera weren't the only ones moving away from the velocity of 80s thrash. In 1992, New York's Biohazard had begun fusing their crossover thrash with quasi-rapped verses to create something akin to rap metal. Brazil's Sepultura would further groove metal on 1993's Chaos AD. And Machine Head bludgeoned Bay Area thrash into exciting new forms with the bone-breaking grooves of 1994's Burn My Eyes. Sweden's Clawfinger can perhaps claim to be the first new metal band. Frontman Zach Tell's love of US hip-hop is shown in him affecting a Grandmaster Flash style flow.
Speak the truth, don't you dare lie to me. I've seen it all before, the way you disagree.
While the guitars replicate screeching Bomb Squad production. But as an all-white band, attempting to debate Public Enemy style racial politics would be contentious. Their first album, 1993's Deaf, Dumb, Blind, was led by a single, the name of which I cannot say on YouTube without getting this video demonetized. An anti-racist, if clumsily written, tirade about how certain words won't lose their power, with a chorus that is just repeated uses of the N-word. Misunderstandings over its intent meant that Clawfinger received death threats, and as a result, have never played the US.
It's a negative word, and the white man made it. Gave you a name to dominate and trade it.
I was a naive 20-year-old. I was angry and I was slightly confused. I didn't think about what I was allowed to say or not. I simply wrote straight from the heart. And for that simple reason, the song will never completely lose its meaning. Hopefully, there won't be any other songs I need to discuss with non-monetizable. After the avalanche of distorted guitars that was grunge, the Sunset Strip became incredibly uncool. So the bands that had moved to Los Angeles to become the next Poison or Motley Crue left. In their absence, the local weirdos took their place. Instead of clouds of hairspray and spandex, from 1992 onwards you could catch primitive versions of Cold Chamber, Deftones and System of Down playing the Whiskey A Go-Go. But the first band to crystallize the new metal sound, as well as get signed to a major label, were Bakersfield, California's KoRn. In tracksuits with unruly dreadlocks, they didn't look like a traditional metal group. But with their 1994 self-titled debut, and its shit-starting opening track, Blind, they would shape the genre for the rest of the decade, and beyond.
Are you ready?
Taking the guitars of Pantera and Helmet, and trying to replicate the hip-hop low end of Cypress Hill and Dr. Dre, they completed the package with the pained wails of Duran Duran-loving, then meth addict, Jonathan Davis. On the lumbering f***, Davis discusses his childhood experiences of bullying.
Why did you tease me, make me feel upset?
How as a teen he'd worn makeup like his beloved New Romantics, and being called the title slur by jocks.
I'm just a pretty boy, whatever you call it, you wouldn't know around me if you saw it.
Which in turn had made him question his sexuality. What is revolutionary about the album is that mainstream metal had never been this vulnerable before. Nirvana's Kurt Cobain also had a troubled childhood, though his primal screams came through in cryptic metaphors. Davis was unflinchingly direct, consumed by demons that he exercised through their debut. The album reaches its most raw moment on the coda of closing sexual abuse confession, Daddy. Davis sobbing in the vocal booth as his band jams around him. It was a song that was necessary, and it helped a lot of people. That's pretty much all I've got to say about it. I dealt with a demon, and it showed that I could get past those demons and come out the better side. Part of this soul-rending metal as therapy was provoked by the needling of fledgling producer Ross Robinson, who, because of his continued work with KoRn, as well as other prominent acts, would be dubbed the godfather of new metal. The album never charted higher than number 72 on the Billboard album chart, but by 1996 it had gone gold. By the end of the decade, double platinum. The impact on the underground, though, was instant, with bands acquiring 7-string guitars to try and replicate the KoRn sound. If we invented new metal, then fuck yeah, cool. It's pretty cool to say we helped invent some kind of movement. That's pretty insane. The last big movement was us. Other bands helped along the way, but we spearheaded that whole thing. Sacramento's Deftones had been around for 6 years by the time they were signed to Madonna's Maverick label. United by a love of skating and weed, the band's influences were split between guitarist Stephen Carpenter's thing for Metallica and Sepultura, and vocalist Chino Moreno's assorted taste in The Cure, Sade, and Beastie Boys. But on their debut, Adrenaline, from 1995, it was Moreno's sometimes rapid, aggravated delivery, the churning metal guitars, and broship with the guys from KoRn that got them flagged as new metal, a label the band have tried to distance themselves from. The explosive single, Seven Words, continued the anti-cop sentiment of their forefathers.
Mr. P.I.G., could I fucking see? Shorty done crushed all of my brothers.
There's definite catharsis in its incensed chorus, but unlike KoRn, it's through scattershot abstract lyricism.
Squeal like a pig when you're...
Moreno has since said there are no lyrics on Adrenaline, just noises, and that's why they aren't printed in the liner notes. However, on the blistering slow burn of opener, Bored.
Get Bored!
Deftones showed the ambition that would allow them to outlast their new metal brethren, even if at the same time they were influencing the next batch. When we were coming up, the Deftones was the band we looked up to. I'd go to their shows and I'd leave going, man, I want to start a band. 1995 was also the year of Down by 311. An alt-rock funk metal tune in the Red Hot Chili Peppers vein. Its serrated guitars, hip-hop scratches, and infectious dancehall vocals made it a modern rock radio number one. Though not exactly new metal, it didn't sound out of place on K-Rock amongst Incubus and Limp Bizkit. On their respective debuts, KoRn and Deftones has been inspired in part by the seething brutality of Sepultura's KSAD, a scuzzy Brazilian spin on Pantera's groove metal. By the time of Sepultura's follow-up, 1996's Roots, as well as absorbing their home country's cultural heritage, they were poaching moves, riffs, and producers from their protégés. Most of the album was recorded by Ross Robinson at Indigo Studios in Malibu, same as KoRn's debut. But Sepultura weren't gonna stand for his non-mixing desk button pushing. We had heard all this stuff about him throwing things at KoRn to get them angry when they were recording. We went in there on the first day and were like, don't you try pulling any shit like that with us. We're from Brazil. We'll f***ing kill you. He never did either. I think he thought we were serious. Furthering the new metal love-in, Jonathan Davis and House of Pain turntablist, later of Limp Bizkit, DJ Lethal, would appear on the track Look Away. Along with unknowing scene forefather, Mike Patton. But not everyone was happy with Sepultura's change in sound. Death metal purists felt that with the single string riffs of Roots Bloody Roots, the band was dumbing themselves down for commercial gain. But it worked. Surprisingly for an album of such extremity, Roots would hit number 27 on the Billboard chart, eventually going gold. The classic Sepultura lineup would last until the end of 1996, before combusting, Max Cavalera leaving due to a dispute over management. Roots was not the only album Robinson would produce in 1996. With him ramping up his confrontational production style on KoRn's sophomore album, Life is Peachy, which hit number 3 on the Billboard Top 200. Here, KoRn would not only visit the theming of Walk, only less subtly, on Good God. But gift us the unforgettable twist. Elsewhere in 1996, separate groups of masked men from Iowa and Ohio were making moves. Iowa's Slipknot unleashed their Corey Taylor-less, Mr. Bungle-obsessed debut, Mate, Feed, Kill, Repeat. While their on-site arch-rivals, Ohio's Mushroom Head, released their second album, Super Buick. Only time would tell who would have the bigger impact on metal. If 1994 was the invention of new metal, 97 was when it became a recognizable movement. Cold Chamber came up in the same scene that spawned KoRn and Deftones. Their self-titled debut, released in February 1997, featured the Devil Speak barrage of Loco. While the Gatling intonation is initially opaque, Des Fafara has stated it's about the stagnant LA scene post-Nirvana, as well as a tribute to the Latino community that first latched upon the band. Loco was about trying to get signed in LA, where all the bands fought each other and there's no radio airplay for heavy music. Nobody was even looking to LA to sign bands. KoRn were lucky to get signed, and we're all lucky that they did. Cold Chambers purposely freakish looking for Farah, and the video for Loco showing him off, foreshadowed many new metal bands trying to look as obscene or inhuman as possible. Whether that is Wayne Static's beard hair combo, or whatever is going on with Mudvayne. Wes Borland from Limp Bizkit also had a variety of out there looks at his disposal, utilizing masks, colored contacts, and grease paint. These theatrics, as well as his mercurial alt-metal guitar work, and the anti-charisma of frontman Fred Durst, were how the Florida band built their initial following. We were the black sheep, or the white sheep. We weren't quite hip-hop, we weren't quite metal, but we just didn't give a f**k. And we always tried to say that fairly blatantly. I think that was one of the things that became dislikable about us. Their debut album, $3 Bill Y'all, released in July 1997, was another Ross Robinson endeavor. On first single Counterfeit, Durst raged against the local clones that had begun Xeroxing their rap metal sound. Alone in your misery, you're buying all my new style. Loud as a counterfeit, going down in history, it's nothing but a copycat. But it was their aggro redo of George Michael's Faith that would push them to the masses. Rock gotta have faith. Ironically, they would then spawn the trend of inappropriately heavy covers of 80s pop songs. Incubus were characterized as surf bros, the sunned children of Red Hot Chili Peppers, frontman Brandon Boyd rivaling even Iggy Pop for never having a shirt on. A Certain Shade of Green is an ever-shifting maelstrom of savage guitar play, relentless slap bass, and aggressive turntablism. Boyd shuffling between singing, rapping, and screaming. Lyrically railing against procrastination, it's a waiting room that never stops. Though they would support KoRn in Europe for 2 months, and had similar influences, like many bands sorted into the new metal movement against their will, Incubus kicked against the label. We were being embraced by some of the new metal champions of the time, an opening for them. And it always made me cringe. So much of new metal was openly misogynistic, and that always felt really weird to me. In October, Deftones returned with Around the Fur. UK top 30 single My Own Summer, Shove It, features Carpenter's serpentine riff, coexisting with Moreno's sexual Sade-esque croon. And throat-slashing howl. Almost disguising its theme that Bananarama knew all too well. Summer can be cruel. Elsewhere on the album, Max Cavalera would feature on the intense Head Up, shouting out his new project. But by 1997, there was new metal popping up everywhere. There was the muscular Faith No More-isms of Atlanta, Georgia's Seven Dust. And also from California, the sadly doomed punk thrash of Snot. The gangster rap punk pile-up of Head PE. And Sugar Ray. Despite their 1997 mega hit being the chill cod reggae of Fly, his parent album Flawed is a mix of Primus worship and new metal bangers. And when the moon is right, you'll get it every night. Go on and play it And even in Germany, Guano Apes had a mainland European pop hit with the deceptively catchy rap metal of Open Your Eyes. ...1998 was the year that nu metal went mainstream. In April, Max Cavalera fully embraced nu metal on the self-titled debut of his new project, Soulfly. More Spartan brutalism, though this time he had Fred Durst along for the ride on the Feral Bleed. When I put your sorry ass in a package, you piece of shit, should they deliver from a savage. In August, the nu metal adjacent Godsmack would release their self-titled breakthrough album, eventually going 4x platinum in the US. Fucking go away, I'm doing the best I ever did, I'm doing the best that I can. Paving the way for the million-selling post-grunge likes of Stained, Creed, and Puddle of Mutt. Britain didn't really get Godsmack, so to me, their most important contribution to popular culture is being purposely misnamed in Bowling for Soup's Girl All the Bad Guys Want. She likes the Godsmack and I like Agent Orange. The summer of 1998 brought the third edition of Ozfest, the annual event for US headbangers to see the biggest bands and potentially catch the next big things in metal. The festival had Cold Chamber on its lineup for the prior two outings, but this year they went big on nu metal. Limp Bizkit, Soulfly, Seven Dust, Incubus, Snot, and opening the main stage, System of a Down. They had been inhabiting the LA scene since 1984, eventually being signed by one of the godfathers of rap rock, Rick Rubin. A head-spinning mix of Slayer thrash, Dead Kennedys politics, and Mr. Bungle oddity, it wasn't the easiest sell. But their June 1998 debut would end up shifting 2 million copies in the US alone. Lyrically, single Sugar cannot sit still, sprinting between domestic violence, substance dependence, and mental instability. Not to mention the choruses, Kombucha Mushroom People. In August, Robert Ritchie, aka Kid Rock, released his fourth album, Devil Without a Cause. Though more rap rock than nu metal, like if Walk This Way was Lynyrd Skynyrd rather than Aerosmith. Its opening track, Bar Wa Ta Bar, still provoked love in the mosh pit. Broadcasting his rap credibility, the song's gibberish chant is actually a collision of old school hip hop ad-libs from Busy Bee and the Sugar Hill Gang. Devil Without a Cause went platinum 11 times. But this was also the year of the Ross Robinson produced new metal album from Vanilla Ice, which featured a heavy angst reworking of the first hip hop number one. Check out the hook while my DJ revolves it. Ice, ice, baby. Due to this influx of bandwagon jumpers with seven string guitars and tracksuits, KoRn felt like the Pied Pipers of new metal. Some of the bands were blatantly ripping us off. That's when we took Follow the Leader in a bit of a different direction, like, let's try to experiment and widen our lane a little bit. That's how the title of the album came about. A sarcastic way of saying, we know y'all are following us, but you don't know what we're gonna do. Though the album was created fueled by a copious amount of sex, drugs, and alcohol, Follow the Leader would debut at number one on the Billboard chart. The slinky disco metal of Got the Life with its high budget video would duel with clips from boy bands on MTV's Daily Pop Rundown, TRL, eventually being the first video to be retired from the chart after remaining on the top 10 for 73 days. Freak on a Leash, when it was released in February 99, would be the first video to top the TRL chart that wasn't NSYNC or Backstreet Boys. KoRn were no longer an underground happening. They were pop. and the Black Hole of Fame was sucking all the bands in their periphery with them into the mainstream. The first single of Follow the Leader, All in the Family, had featured Jonathan Davis trading playground insults and homophobic barbs in a pseudo-rap battle with one Fred Durst.
Who's hot, who's not? You best step back. KoRn on the cob, you need a new job.
Within a year, the internationally famous red-capped face of new metal's enduring disaster.
It's just one of those days.
In 1999, new metal continued unabated. Slipknot released their merciless self-titled album.
I tried, you lied on me for so long.
Machine Head made their attempt at the genre complete with Rob Flynn's bizarre hair decision. And the world got their first taste of Crazy Town. But most significantly, it was also the year that Limp Bizkit put out Significant Other, and Fred Durst would be crowned the Clown Prince of New Metal. The heroically dumb Nookie would crib lyrics from Eve 6. And be the second New Metal TRL chart topper. An existential screed provoked by an unfaithful lover. Its energy and porno beat would help push Significant Other to 16 million copies sold worldwide. The video for second single Break Stuff would feature cameos not just from Jonathan Davis, but hip-hop heavyweights Dr. Dre, Snoop Dogg, and an on-the-rise Eminem. While disguised as a chainsaw-packing nugget of macho posturing,
it's just one of those days, feeling like a freight train, first one to complain, leaves with the blood stain.
Break Stuff was custom built to commiserate every teenager's worst day with guttural guitar stabs and stuff breaking release.
Give me something great.
Durst had had his teenage self in mind when writing these songs, bullied and alone. But like Kurt Cobain before him, he now found that the same kind of people who had victimized him as a kid were listening to. They'd ruined my life, and I thought they'd ruined our fans' lives as well. I really thought that people were identifying where I was coming from. A guy who finally got to stand up and fight back. The irony was that the bullies themselves started to like the music. So when Limp Bizkit played the train wreck that was Woodstock 99 alongside KoRn and Red Hot Chili Peppers, a lot of the blame for the destruction was aimed at Durst, supposedly inciting the violence.
The whole world is watching us right now, and the whole world is watching you. Let's put out some positive vibes in this motherfucker and have a big ass party.
In the new millennium, Linkin Park and Papa Roach would come to prominence with multi-million selling albums.
Everything you say to me,
while Limp Bizkit scored a UK number one single with the incorrigible Roland, Air Raid Vehicle. But the movement's initial good faith had expired. Because the music itself required little in the way of technical ability, the scene had quickly become overloaded by a surfeit of mediocre bandwagon jumpers. Ross Robinson had already turned his back on the genre he helped create, instead producing the post-hardcore of At The Drive-In and Glassjaw. By 2003, most of the first wave of bands had either become self-parody or left the genre altogether. But surprisingly, the music endures. The nostalgia cycle has turned so that new metal is back in vogue. The Sick New World Festival is packed with the era's biggest acts. While perception of Limp Bizkit has transformed from the McDonald's of metal to beloved dad rock. Not only that, but a new wave of bands are taking the best bits of the genre and infusing it in their cutting-edge tunes. From metalcore upstarts to alt-pop divas.
I close my eyes.
What's incredible about nu metal is that for a brief moment, this unrefined, ugly music became extremely popular. Not just popular in extreme music terms, but some of the best-selling albums of all time popular. From a modern point of view, the casual homophobia and misogyny is undoubtedly jarring, but nu metal expressed real, awkward, uncomfortable emotions, and was genuinely cathartic for those that needed it, and was a true alternative to the often insincere, unrelatable chart pop of the day. So when it's one of those days when you don't want to wake up, you know what time is. Thanks for watching. Do you think I missed anything? Comment down below. If you like this video, like, subscribe, and why don't you also do me a favor and share it with a couple of people? It really does help. As always, I'd like to shout out my new top tier supporters over on Patreon. Mike Reynolds, Will Columbine, Mike, David W. Washington, Justin Anderson, and Future Space Hoppers. And thanks again to all that support me, and I'll see you in 2 weeks for a return to Britpop.